podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
Where are the DP brains localized? Well, I could say that the DP brains, the solutions they had are localized at R equals zero. But I think it's probably better to say that they are around that area. It's not that there's a physical object in there, because, for example, for the D3 brain, there's no singularity. So the space-time is completely non-singular. So if there's no singularity, I mean, it's not that you have an object in at some point which is sourcing the geometry, right? But I think that the answer is that they are in the near horizon region. So the degrees of freedom corresponding to that object are localized around close to R equals zero. It's a bit of a subtle question, and it has to do also with AdSCFT, what it means, but yeah, you could say that it's kind of at around R equals zero. Yes, near R equals to zero, that's where the degrees of freedom that describe the proper dynamics of that object are localized. That's kind of answer to that. Yeah. Yes.
Sorry. Can I ask you, how to know the thickness of the brain?
So there are several. One length scale that you can have for this object. One of them is the charge radius. So the charge gives you a length scale, but the thickness. Well, in principle, if you're in string theory, you also have the string length. So depending on what kind of probe you're using, you're going to find that the object has a different thickness or size. You may want to measure the thickness of the object by performing some scattering experiment and finding what the...
But it's again, you can measure thickness density.
Yeah, so there are several scales that you can find, and some probes are going to see this object with some size, and some probes are going to see this object with another size. So it's kind of a question-dependent statement. Okay, so last thing that we saw is that we have these supergravity solutions for DP brains. We had the extremal ones. There was a particular one, the case of the D3 brain, which was better behaved than the others, in the sense that it was non-singular. The size of the transverse sphere was kept constant. But then we saw also that the area of the horizon of this object went to zero, essentially because there was a contraction of the wall volume of the D brain along the longitudinal directions, because it has tension, and this made the area of the extremal D3 brain go to zero. Now, what I want to do in this lecture, at the beginning of this lecture, what I want to do is to describe a way of constructing an extremal black hole that carries charges of D brains and which has non-zero area. Why do I want to do this? Well, because first of all, because extremal black holes are simpler than non-extremal ones. They have zero temperature, and in many cases they can be embedded as supersymmetric solutions of a supergravity theory, and supersymmetry is something that gives us a good handle on the properties of the solution. So I want to find an object, a black hole, also with D-brain charges. I want to know what charges this object has. The Schwarzschild black hole is very simple, but the Schwarzschild black hole is kind of a black box in the sense that, well, we just have its energy, its mass, and we don't know any other details about it. If we have the charges of a black hole, and in particular if we have we know that the black hole carries charges of D brains, then this helps us identify what may be the microscopic constituents that make this black hole in string theory, right? So if we know that the black hole has D1 charge, then we know that we should be thinking about it in terms of an object that in string theory corresponds to a D1 brain. If it has D5 brain charges, then we know that we should be looking at D5 brains in string theory, and so on. So I want to construct a black hole in string theory with non-zero area, which is extremal, and which has a well-defined set of D brain charges. Well, so the brains that I described the other day, none of them has this property. We know that they have charges, we take the extremal limit, but then the horizon disappears and we're left with something that In many cases, it's a singularity. But then we can combine different brains, the good properties of one of them with the good properties of another one, and try to see whether we can, in the end, end up with something within the non-zero area. And what I'm going to begin with, can you see this? I mean, this is, there's a horizon over here, so maybe I'll okay. So the horizon disappears. No, you can't see. So we're going to combine the fundamental string and the NS5 brain in a configuration which looks a bit like this. Of course, I cannot draw all the directions, but this is going to be a direction that I'm going to call 1. These are directions 2, 3, 4, and 5. So the 5 brain, which has 5 extends along the 5 spatial directions, corresponds to these directions, and the fundamental string is extended along this direction, right? So I draw this like this. This is a fundamental string, and this is the NS5 brain. People sometimes represent this by saying, so these are the 9 spatial directions in string theory. There's also time. But the fundamental string is extended along the direction 1, and the 5 brain is extended along these directions. So how do I find a supergravity solution that has the charges of these two objects? Well, it turns out that in this case, that's fairly easy to do, because I just have to combine the solution from one to the and the solution with the other, and miraculously, this gives the right solution. So let me write it. And the dilaton, I'm not writing the other fields, the gauge fields, but they are straightforward. Now, if you go back to the notes and have a look at what the solution was for a fundamental string and what the solution was for a NS5 brain, you could see that if we set H1 to 1, so we set this Q1, which corresponds to the fundamental string charge, if we set this to 0, this, if we just left with this, then this would be the solution for an NS5 brain. Okay? This is in a string frame. On the other hand, if we set Q5 to 0, then this solution has the same structure as the solution for a fundamental string. There's a different power in here, but this just means that we're kind of spreading the fundamental string charge along all the directions of the 5 brain. That's a technical point that I don't want to enter in. But you just have to look at this, the structure of this solution. I've just taken this solution terms in, written in terms of some harmonic functions, and it turns out that this is a solution. This is not always the case. I mean, you cannot always construct supergravity solutions like this for brain intersections or brain combinations of different brains. But in the cases where you have two objects whose dimensionality differs by 4, so that's 5 minus 1 is 4, then in many of these cases, this rule, this kind of what people call the harmonic function rule, that you just combine harmonic functions, in these cases, it's quite often a rule that works. Yes? So here I have R squared and R squared. Is this what you're asking? Yeah. So for the 5 brain, this was the right power, right? Because we already had the R squared. For the fundamental string, we had a different power over here. So the reason is that what we're doing here is that we're considering not just one fundamental string, but a number of them. So the, yeah, this is something that I didn't want to. So in principle, we saw that we could have a solution. And here this would be 6. So this would, we could have a multi-center solution. Okay. Now, if I consider that I have a continuous distribution of them, and then I integrate over all the positions, then I'm going to get, so I integrate over the directions here would be 2, 3, 4, and 5. Then I'm kind of smearing the fundamental string charts along all these directions. And these powers of here, what they're going to do is that I'm going to end up with a total charge by R squared, right? This is a process that's called smearing or delocalizing the fundamental string along the directions of the five brain. So I have the solution over here. And well, this retains still the good property of the five brain, that the size of the transverse sphere remains of finite size as I go close to R equals 0. Okay. But, well, it still doesn't have a horizon, or a good horizon, because here this I have tension contracting the direction along the string and giving me still a zero area, right? So I have, when I compute the area at R equals zero, I'm going to have a factor like this, besides the factor of the sphere over here, and this goes to zero. Okay? Because I have this 1/H1, and that goes to zero at R equals zero. So I have tension. I'm stabilizing this sphere, but I still have tension contracting the directions along the string. Now, in order to balance this tension, I have to introduce some pressure. And a way to introduce pressure is by boosting, by introducing velocity, by introducing momentum along the direction of the string. The momentum has the effect of introducing pressure. This is something that you can check if you have a look at one of the exercises that we discussed, that I gave you the other day. So, to this configuration, to the fundamental string with a five brain, I'm going to add a momentum wave. And again, the way to do it is just by introducing the harmonic function that corresponds to a momentum wave. So the metric is here this 2, 3, 4, 5 directions. And the dilaton doesn't change because this is the momentum wave didn't have any non-trivial dilaton. And the functions are I is 1, 5, or p. Okay. So I have a combination of three ingredients, the fundamental string, the five brain, and the momentum wave. If I set any two of them to zero, then I get, for example, if I set the five brain and string charge to zero, then I recover the momentum wave that we saw at the beginning of the previous lecture. Okay. Now, one thing to observe in this solution as well as in this one is that the dilaton remains finite as I send R to zero. Okay? So this goes to Q5 over Q1. In fact, this was my main reason for introducing here the fundamental string in addition to the five brain, because I want, if the dilaton blows up, then I'm going to get a strong coupling in some regions, and that wasn't a good thing if I want to relate this configuration to something that appears in perturbative strings, right? So I want to stabilize the dilaton. I've stabilized the dilaton by introducing the fundamental string. And now what I'm doing is stabilizing the direction along the string by introducing some momentum. I have the tension of the string and stabilizing it with the momentum with the pressure that the momentum creates. Now, this is a solution in a stream frame, but I can take this configuration to be as a configuration in the 2B theory and then apply S-duality. I mean. In order to go to where to apply S-duality, I first go to the Einstein frame. So before I do that, I go to the Einstein frame, and the metric in Einstein frame is just this one, okay? And this is H1, H5. So I see here that the fact that the dilaton remains finite at the horizon is a good thing, because if the area remains finite in one frame, it's going to remain finite in the other frame, right? I can compute what's the area. So, well, you can just work out what's the Einstein frame metric by just introducing this additional factor in front of this. And then I can compute what's the area of the horizon at r equals 0. So we have the volume of the three sphere over here multiplied by the square root of the square root here of H5. I have it three times. So I have this is from this, and then I have to introduce the rest of the coefficients from this part of the metric. And well, if I do that, then that's square root HP over H1 and square root of H1 over H5 to the 8 to the 4th. Well, this comes from this, and this comes from the change from Einstein frame to from string frame to Einstein frame. Now, if you now take R goes to 0, then this is, well, this turns out to be just Q1, Q5, Qp. Okay. Yes? Yes? X, which is X1. Yeah. So you see that here we have a component DAT, DX1. This is telling you that you have something traveling along the direction X1. Okay. It's along the direction of the fundamental string. Yeah, sorry, I should have said that. Yes. So we found that here this is a solution that has a regular horizon at r equals 0 with non-zero area. It's an extremal solution, so it has zero temperature, zero surface gravity, but it has this nice property. Okay. And now, since this is a good solution in the the F1 NS5 momentum solution has is a black hole with non-zero area, and we can take it in the 2B theory. Then, if we S-dualize it to a solution that would have, if we S-dualize the F1, this goes to a D1, the NS5 goes to a D5, and momentum goes to momentum. And the rest duality. Okay. We saw the other day that S duality that has this effect. The S duality on the momentum wave, the momentum is just a pure metric excitation, and the metric didn't change. The Einstein frame metric didn't change under S duality. So we find a black hole with D1, D5, D5 charges, D1, D5 and momentum charges with non-zero area and made up of these objects. Okay. Any questions? Okay, so we have the solution up there. The Einstein frame solution would be the same for the D1, D5 momentum, and the F1, NS5 momentum, the metric, should be the same. Well, we also, one of the things that we have there is we have these four directions, X2, X3, X4, and X5, which are not playing any role. They are kind of spectator directions. We can take them to be compactified on a torus. If we consider them to be periodic, then this would be a four torus. For those of you who know about these things, we could just as well take, instead of a T4, we could take a K3 surface. It would break some of the supersymmetries, but at the level of the supergravity solution, it wouldn't change much. So we could compactify these directions and find a solution in six dimensions. So within 10, we perform a reduction, dimensional reduction along these four directions. Then we can go to the Einstein frame metric in six dimensions. We have a solution in 6D, which is just a conformal rescaling of the metric up there without the four directions that we have. So the six-dimensional solution have a six-dimensional solution here, which is like the six-dimensional part that we have up there, up to a conformal rescaling that depends on the functions H1 and H5. Since the dilaton and all the functions, all the coefficients that appear here are finite, because we have designed the solution so that everything is kind of stabilized, then this again is a solution with the same area. Sorry? So this is X1. X1 runs, well, we can make it periodic, and we're going to make it periodic. So it goes from 0 to 2 pi r. T goes from minus infinity to plus infinity. And r, in principle, we take it in this range, because r equals 0, that's the horizon. That's where these coordinates are valid. Then we can extend it across the horizon. Of the torus, I have performed a Kaluza-Klein reduction, which I haven't explained in the lectures because I didn't have the time to do it, but I can just perform a Kaluza-Klein reduction and forget about them. Nothing depends on them, so they play a spectator role. If I compactify them on a torus of a small enough size, then the dynamics in that direction is going to decouple. Okay, so I have this. This is a six-dimensional string. So the four directions that we had, so now we've gone from this, then I take these directions to be compactified, and what I end up with, when the size of this circle is sufficiently small, is with a string with D1, D5 charges, and momentum along the direction of the string, right? So this is the D1, D5 string, a six-dimensional solution for a D1, D5 string with momentum. You can see that this is a dionic string in six dimensions because the D1 is electric charge of the Ramon-Ramon three-form field strength, and the D5 is magnetically charged with respect to this field. Right? So this has electric and magnetic charges under this three-form field strength. This black hole is the first black hole for which a stringy microscopic interpretation of its entropy was obtained. This is sometimes called the Strominger-Buffa black hole. And it is the black hole that has become the best laboratory that we have in order to study microscopic properties of black holes in string theory. So it's a rather important solution. I think that at this double car next week will work quite a bit with this, with the properties of this solution. Okay? Yes?
Is it not that ADS2 is more simpler than this?
ADS2 is simpler, yes. But we don't have such a good understanding of the microscopic interpretation of it. Right. One of the reasons that we have a good understanding of the properties of this solution is what I'm going to say now. So the other day we saw that it's interesting to analyze the near horizon geometry of this kind of configurations of D brains. We took a decoupling limit for the D3 brain where we were decoupling the asymptotically flat region and we were left with the region near the horizon. And this is also something that we can do for this solution. We can go close to the horizon, decouple the asymptotically flat region, because this solution is asymptotically flat in the directions transverse to the string. So this asymptotically flat region, we can also decouple it by taking a limit where we regard that Q1 and Q5 are much larger than this momentum charge, and also than the scale, all length scales in the transverse direction. Okay. So when we take this, the 1 and 5 harmonic functions, they go to this. So the 1s drop, and we get this. This is, again, an exact solution, again, because this is these are harmonic functions on their own. So what do we get when we take this limit? The near horizon, the decoupling limit. Of the D1, D5P solution. What we find? The following. So there are some things that should be already familiar to you. Here we have this sphere, three sphere, which factorizes out. It has radius, so Q1 and Q5 have dimensions of length squared. So this sphere has a radius, which is Q1, Q5 to the 1/4. I think the notes, there's a square missing. So we have a sphere, a three sphere of constant size, and then we have another three-dimensional part, because this is, we have a total of six dimensions, three of the dimensions are a sphere. What is the rest, the other three-dimensional part? Well, one of the things that you can do is compute what is the curvature of this three-dimensional space. You can compute what's the Riemann tensor, and then you will find that the Riemann tensor is constant. That's proportional to the metric. Well, to the combination of the metric with the same symmetries of the Riemann tensor, right? So this is a constant curvature space. and it's negative constant curvature. So it's a negative constant curvature space in three dimensions, which means that this is locally, at least, anti-de Sitter space in three dimensions. Right? That's a space-time with constant negative curvature. Why do I say locally? Because the curvature only tells you about the local properties, not the global properties of space-time. Yeah. And it may be something that's globally different than ADS3, and this is in fact going to be the case. So if we take, in order to analyze the properties of the solution, what we're going to do is to change coordinates to see whether we can find a metric that we can recognize more easily. So first thing that I do, I define this quantity. This is the curvature radius of the sphere, but also of the ADS3 space. So it's as a, this has a constant curvature radius. The curvature radius is this quantity L. And then I also identify x, well, I'm dropping the index 1 from dx. I identify this, like I said. I want this now to be identified in this direction. But this radius is much longer than the radius of the torus. Right? So this is something that I don't say here, but the radius of this is 1. Is much longer than the radius of the around the torus directions. So I don't see this torus, but I still see the directions of this string. And then I do the following changes. So if I have this, then one of the things that I can do is to define an angular coordinate phi, which is not any of the angular coordinates here. I define here a dimensionless variable, which is periodic with canonical periodicity 2 pi. And I also introduce a new radial coordinate that I call rho squared. Okay? And I call qp, this is L squared over R squared, rho plus squared. So the horizon was at r equals 0, so I call the place where rho, the value of rho that corresponds to the horizon, I call it rho plus. And I also rescale the time coordinate by a constant. Now if I do these changes, then this geometry over here becomes then I have the okay. So this is the same near horizon geometry that I had before written in different coordinates. Right? So this is what we find close to the horizon of the D1D5 momentum system. So I have the three sphere and I have this part. This three-dimensional space, this is a black hole. We can recognize some of the properties of black holes because it has the same structure as we saw in the exercise, the first exercise that I gave you. But now it's an extremal one in the sense that this is a double zero. So this means that the black hole is extremal. Here, at rho equals rho plus, you have a double zero. So it's a degenerate horizon. This is known as the extremal Bañados-Teitelbaum-Zanelli black hole. BTC black hole. Okay. And this by itself is a solution to three-dimensional gravity with a negative cosmological constant. So this three-dimensional solution is a solution to this theory as well, in three dimensions. Okay. Just like this is a solution to three-dimensional Euclidean gravity with a positive cosmological constant. This one is a solution to three-dimensional gravity, Lorentzian one, with a negative cosmological constant. So this is one way in which three-dimensional gravity becomes relevant for the physics of black holes in other dimensions, in higher dimensions. This is the extremal one, but if we had started, so the other day we saw that if we start, instead of starting from the extremal solution and then applying the dualities, if we start from the non-extremal solutions, say, we apply a boost to a black string, but this is not, we don't take the boost velocity to the speed of light. If we apply all the dualities and everything, then we end up with a solution which resembles this one, but then it has a horizon at a position which is at some value of r larger than zero. We had some additional metric functions. So one can construct an extremal version of this, and then when you take the near horizon limit, then what you find is the non-extremal version of the BTC black hole. And that's in the notes. I'm not going to write it down, but you have in the notes how the near horizon limit corresponds to, in the non-extremal case, corresponds to the non-extremal BTC black hole. Okay. Where are they in the space-time? So you have the answer is the same as before. You cannot localize them at one place. The physics takes place in the region near the horizon. But all you have is gravitational degrees of freedom. All you have is closed string the degrees of freedom. If you want to have something that corresponds to a physical object, then you would be asking for the open string description of the system. And in order to do this, you have to go to the CFT dual of this ABS. So the solution doesn't have any, this solution doesn't have any curvature singularities, because it's a space-time with a constant curvature, so the curvature is smooth everywhere. There are some mild singularities, null orbifold, well, orbifold singularities in some cases, but you cannot say that the D brain is at some point. Right? Just like in the case of the Schwarzschild black hole, you cannot say, well, there's an object, it's an object with a finite size. It's not that you have some localized point like source for the object. Here you don't have the D-brains in any place. The D-brains represent the space-time. All the space-time corresponds to the D-brains, right? So, well, I leave things here. Of course, this is incomplete, but the completion of this, I mean, this is the starting point now for many of the microscopic analysis of black holes in string theory, but this will be the subject of other lectures. So I'll stop here, and then I'm going to change to another topic. So before I change to the next topic, are there any questions for this? There's no curvature singularity, in the sense that, the curvature is constant, so it doesn't blow up anywhere. There are some milder singularities in some regions, so and they correspond to kind of generalizations of conical singularities. A conical singularity is a localized distributional source of... This is a black hole solution. It's a black hole solution. It has a horizon. It has an event horizon, so not only a killing horizon, but it has an event horizon in the sense that there's a region that's not connected, causally connected to null infinity. So in that sense, yeah, it's a good horizon. You don't need a singularity in order to have a horizon. Yes?
Only such a special type of black holes, which contracts on the EGN's configurations, can be analyzed from the microscopic or 3D point of view.
Well,
you can some kind of apply this technique to the usual kind of black holes.
So for this, I mean, it's so these are the ones that are simpler, because in this case we know, we can know in the, in a sense what they are made of.
Yeah.
We know that they are made of this, so this gives us a good clue for what to look for in the microscopic string theory. For Schwarzschild, I'm not saying that we don't know that it's impossible, but what I'm saying is that it's much harder, because you have to take into account everything that can exist with a given mass, whereas here we have to study only configurations that have this kind of charges. Yes? A double zero, yeah. So at rho equal rho plus, you have double, so this, yeah, so I have at rho near rho equals rho plus, this behaves like rho minus rho plus square plus, well, some finite factor. Yes. You can compute the surface gravity, and then you will see that you can compute the surface gravity, and you will see that it is zero. So if you try to do, for example, what we did in the first exercise the other day, where the metric near the horizon was of some in the form of some Rindle space. And then you will find that this is not Rindle space, because one of the factors goes to zero, the one that came with the kappa. Okay. Okay, any more questions? There are other brain configurations that are also good, which you can consider, for example, intersections of M5 brains, and they also give you near the horizon an AdS3 factor, times a two sphere instead of a three sphere, and that's also a very good system to study in string theory or in M theory. And there are there's quite a variety of black holes that we can understand, but this was the first, and it's still the simplest and the best in many respects. Yes. So these are solutions to 2B closed string theory. So there are no open strings. But then if I go to the microscopic description, then there I will have D brains in the perturbative string sense, and then there will be open strings sending on them. But here there are no open strings.
But would the same thing work in this theory with open strings?
There are no open strings. It's this is 2B string theory. I don't have open strings here. The open strings, I'm describing them in a dual form in terms of the gravitational solution. That's AdSCFT. Okay. Okay, so any more questions? Yes?
So can you explain this decoupling unit? Why do I take Q1, Q5 to be?
Because that's what's giving me this near horizon region, this nice near horizon region. There are other ways of, I mean, from the CFT point of view, that's also a good limit to take. But from the supergravity point of view, that's the way to decouple the asymptotically flat region and be left with a near horizon region that has this BTC black hole near the horizon.
So had I taken QP also greater than
QP, I wanted to remain finite of the same size as the length scales that I have. So I have QP of the same order, parametric order, as the R square. So I'm keeping this as a scale, one scale that doesn't go to infinity. Because I need it to remain like that if I want the horizon to remain in place. So now I'm going to describe some things about black hole thermodynamics. I guess that many of you have seen some black hole thermodynamics, but I'm going to review some of the basics for you. So one of the main results of the study of black holes in the 60s and early 70s was the establishment, people were able to show that classical black holes satisfy a number of properties which were known as the laws of black hole mechanics, which were put together and formalized in a paper by Bardeen, Carter, and Hawking. So these are some properties that black holes were proven to satisfy in general. There was a zeroth law, which said that the surface gravity kappa is uniform over an equilibrium horizon, that's a Keating horizon. Killing here, I'm taking it to be equivalent to a situation of equilibrium where you have a stationary equilibrium. This is a non-trivial property. In principle, the surface gravity could change from one point in the horizon to another point in the horizon. But under some conditions, it's possible to prove that the surface gravity is uniform over the horizon. Then there's a first law, which says that if you take the parameters of the black hole, like mass, area, angular momentum, and so on, then they have to satisfy this, a property like this. And here by the dots, I mean that if you have charges, then you also have work terms that appear in the way that you could expect them. And then there's a second law, which is that the total area of a system of black holes, the total area of the event horizon of a configuration with possibly an arbitrary number of black holes, the area cannot decrease in time. Okay. So these are obviously, the way that they were written, the way that they were numbered, they are obviously very similar to the laws of thermodynamics. The zeroth law tells you that in a situation of equilibrium, the temperature is uniform over a system. The first law would be like this, but in the first law of thermodynamics, instead of this term, you would have T dS, where T and S are the entropies of the temperature and the entropy of the system. And this would be the internal energy. And then the second law of thermodynamics is the law that the entropy cannot decrease. Okay. So these were analogous to the laws of thermodynamics, but I don't know if you have seen the proofs of these theorems, but they look as different from the proofs of the laws of thermodynamics as they are as different as they can be. Right? So they seem to be striking analogies, but whether there's something deeper than an analogy wasn't clear at all. Okay. But nevertheless, this is very suggestive. And Bekenstein was bold enough to take this suggestion further and say that the area is actually a measure of the entropy of a black hole. That once we identify the area with the entropy of a black hole, the entropy, if you measure it in units where the Boltzmann constant is dimensionless, if you measure energy and temperature in the same units, then the entropy should be proportional to the area with a proportionality factor. This is a numerical factor that Bekenstein couldn't determine, and this is something that you have to put just on dimensional grounds. This is the something that has dimensions of area. So Bekenstein proposed this relationship, and once you have this, then you must also have, if you want to take this seriously, that the temperature should be, the temperature of a black hole should be proportional to the surface gravity with a proportionality factor like this. So this constant C is the same in both cases. It disappears in expressions like this, but Bekenstein couldn't determine it. Now, there was an obvious objection to this idea that entropy corresponds to, that the entropy corresponds to an area, and this objection was immediately raised. The objection is the following. If S is an entropy, and well, if we think that the entropy, thermodynamic entropy, is something that comes from statistical mechanics, you know that the entropy in statistical mechanics can decrease. Yes?
How would one define the temperature of a black hole? It can emit black body radiation, can it?
Okay, so that's what I'm going to say now, right? So, if you, the thing is, you want to take this further. You say area is like entropy. If area is like entropy, then the black hole should have some temperature. And then there's a problem, because if the black hole has temperature, then it should be able to radiate things, and nothing can escape from a black hole, right? So this was the obvious objection, right? Put another way, in statistical mechanics, the second law doesn't have absolute validity, it's only a statistical statement. The entropy can fluctuate, and locally it can decrease a little bit, but the entropy as a whole should grow in time, right? So the validity of the of this theorem, if this analogy is to be taken seriously, the validity of this theorem should be only approximate. It should be possible, if this is, if we take this seriously, it should be possible for a black hole to emit something, to emit particles. This emission of particles, the emission rate, should be suppressed by this, so there can be fluctuations in which the entropy decreases. These fluctuations are suppressed by a Boltzmann type of factor. And say that you have a black hole that emits a particle with frequency omega and with angular momentum m, azimuthal angular momentum m. So if we have the first law, then we should have, this should hold, the variation of the mass of the black hole is the energy that the particle carries away, the variation of the angular momentum is the angular momentum that the particle carries away. So then, this means that the absolute value of the variation of the entropy of the black hole, minus m, this is minus m omega over t. Okay. Omega is the frequency, so imagine that you have a particle. Oh, this is the rotation velocity, the angular velocity of the black hole. Sorry. Okay. It's a quantity that we can define for a classical black hole, the angular velocity. So if the black hole is able to emit a particle with these properties, then the emission rate should be like this. So if we take seriously the idea that the area of the black hole corresponds to an entropy, then the black hole should be able to emit particles with a thermal spectrum at temperature T and with a chemical potential that corresponds to omega h. Okay. So this means that black holes shouldn't be completely black, but they should be able to emit particles. And of course, I think that you all have heard this story, that then there was someone, Stephen Hawking, who tried to prove Bekenstein wrong, and then he found that, to his surprise, that Bekenstein wasn't wrong, that Bekenstein was right, because Hawking found, by analyzing quantum effects in the presence of a black hole, that the black hole does emit particles with a temperature which is given by this. So this is Hawking's big result in 1974. This is the famous Hawking radiation. So by doing this, Hawking was able to determine that this quantity, this constant, C, is 1/4. So the black hole entropy is 1/4 of the area in Planck units. Which is a famous formula. It's probably the most important formula in all of quantum black hole physics. It's valid for black holes that can be described at least as classical or semi-classical. And it's also valid for the black hole at the center of the galaxy. Yeah. For the black hole at the center of the galaxy, the 3 million solar mass black hole, this formula is also valid. And one of the exercises of, that you have for today is to compute what's the entropy of this galactic black hole. Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
So this second law you prove in normal general relativity with
yes.
the Bayes-Schwarz equation, which uses the equations of motion.
Right? Yes.
But in string theory, you have the stringy corrections to the equations of motion.
Good.
So
good.
Is it proven that you still have the second law of string theory?
So you have a... Okay, that's a good question. Probably Atis will say things about this. This is valid as long as gravity is described. So you have a theory of gravity where you have the Einstein-Hilbert term is what describes the gravitational sector. If you have other corrections, then you have to use a different form from the entropy. But then you can prove in general that if you have this, then in fact having a gravitational action with this term is equivalent to having this. You could start from here, go there. This is what Jacobson did, for example. I'm not sure whether today we're going to be able to show this in generality, but it's going to be in the notes if you want to check it. So, any more questions?
Entropy is
yes.
often is proportional to logarithm of the number of states.
Okay, that's in statistical mechanics.
What are the states here?
Okay, so that's a question that people asked for almost 20 years, and then Strominger and Wafa came up with an answer in string theory. And that's what Atis should explain to you next week. So that's a very good question. It's a natural question. But it was a very difficult question to answer. And I think, in my opinion, that's one of the most important successes of string theory, to be able to do that, to compute this as the logarithm of a set of microstates. Before I go on. So one of the things that you can see is that this is in fact in good agreement with what we know about classical black holes, because it's telling us that if we have a classical black hole, if we fix the area, and if we send h bar to zero, then that emission rate goes to zero. So this is, in fact, you could say that this is in perfect agreement with the fact that a classical black hole cannot radiate anything. It's only when we include effects of H-bar, quantum effects, that the black hole radiates. In fact, in some other cases, I think that this is the best way of seeing whether something is a black hole. If you have that in the limit H goes to zero, the emission rate goes to zero, then that object could be a black hole. Let me see what I use now. Lectures on black holes and on window cleaning at the same time. Okay, so if we apply this to the Schwarzschild black hole, for the Schwarzschild black hole we had already seen that the surface gravity is this. So the temperature is h bar pi over 8p. Okay. So this temperature is typically very small because it has this h bar in front. You can compute that for a solar mass black hole, if you plug in here the mass of the sun, then the temperature is on the order of 10 to the minus 6 or 10 to the minus 7 Kelvin, which is colder than the microwave background by several orders of magnitude. So that temperature for astrophysical black holes is completely negligible. That's because we have this H bar over here. There's also one thing that you can see. What's the wavelength of a quantum that the black hole emits? So the typical wavelength is going to be the thermal wavelength, the length scale associated to this temperature. The thermal wavelength is h bar over t. So this is of this order, up to factors of 2 some pi's. So the wavelength of the radiation is comparable to the size of the black hole. This is the Schwarzschild radius. Okay? So the black hole, this is the black hole, the wavelength of the radiation is comparable to the size of the black hole. So the black hole is a small radiator in this sense. Small radiator is an object that has a size which is smaller or comparable to the size of the radiation that it emits. The sun is a big radiator. The wavelength of the photons that come from the sun is much smaller than the size of the sun, but for the black hole that's different. Another property of this temperature is that the temperature goes to infinity as the mass goes to zero. The temperature increases as the mass decreases. You have this is the dependence that you have, it's 1 over m. So one of the things that this means, well, if you have a black hole and it's emitting radiation, then of course the black hole is losing mass because it's losing energy. So as the black hole is losing mass, its temperature goes up, and as the black hole shrinks and shrinks farther and farder, the black hole will have a higher and higher temperature, so it will begin producing particles with higher and higher energy. So in the evaporation of a black hole, you scan the entire spectrum of particle physics. So if a black hole were evaporating out there, a microscopic black hole were evaporating out there, at some point, well, initially it would produce photons and neutrinos and gravitons, that's particles with which are massless or with small mass. When the temperature of the black hole reaches, say, a scale of the order of the MeV, then it will begin to produce electron and positron pairs. The black hole will keep shrinking, the temperature will keep growing up. When the temperature is about the GeV, then it will produce protons, then it will begin to produce Ws and Zs, then Higgs bosons, so the black hole will be producing Higgs bosons, or they may have been producing Higgs bosons way before the LHC, and then anything that's beyond, it will be produced during the evaporation of the black hole, right? Well, the approximation that we have breaks down at the Planck scale, but that's kind of a limit. So anything that is below the Planck scale will be produced by the black hole. Okay. This thing that the temperature grows as the black hole loses energy, this is also telling us that the black hole has negative specific heat. What is the specific heat? The heat capacity of a black hole. Well, this is TdS dt. Now, if you use the fact that for a neutral black hole, this is mass, this is dm dt, and you see that since the slope here is negative, this is negative, so the black hole has negative specific heat. In fact, for the Schwarzschild black hole, this is you can very easily do the calculation, is minus 8 pi m squared. Yes?
Is there some observable effects about that?
Well, there are potentially observable effects, but none of them has been observed yet. Unless you take the point of view that the quark gluon plasma atric is the dual of a black hole. But I'm not going to, and that's a different set of lectures, not my lectures. But in principle, yeah. So Hawking, right after he wrote, he found this, he also wrote a paper about the potentially observable consequences of microscopic black holes in the universe. And then there are also potential observable consequences if black holes are produced at the LHC. Black holes were produced. So in principle, this has potential observable consequences, and we hope that someday we observe them.
We hope we shall produce one at LHC.
Maybe. I mean, if there are large extra dimensions, the scale of gravity is low and so on, yeah. Well, if we can produce black holes at the LHC, it won't be just one. It will be plenty of them. But I'm not going to, I mean, I can discuss this in private with you, but that's not what I'm going to discuss in these lectures. Well, negative specific heat, this means that the black hole is thermodynamically unstable. This is just saying that typically positive specific heat means that if a system loses energy, then typically the temperature also goes down and the system goes back to equilibrium. But here it's the opposite. The black hole is losing energy. If it loses energy, then the temperature goes up and then it wants to lose more energy. So it's kind of a runaway process. Once it begins to lose some energy, then this goes in a runaway fashion. And it's also the other way around. If the black hole absorbs some energy, then it cools down and then it loses less energy. Right? So it's you're at the top of an inverted it's like you're here, right? So you're going to go in either direction, but you're going to be in a stable situation. So you cannot keep a black hole, if you try to put a black hole in a box of radiation, then this radiation you can put it at this temperature, so the radiation would be in equilibrium with the black hole. But then whenever there's a little imbalance between how much radiation the black hole emits and how much radiation it absorbs from the bath, then the black hole will go away from the equilibrium configuration. This happens at least as long as the black hole is much smaller than the box. One can put it also in a larger box and then an equilibrium state will happen, but this we'll see later. This property that thermodynamic instability, this negative specific heat, by the way, is something that's not as pathological as it may seem, because it happens also typically in systems which are self-gravitating. Stars, they also have a negative specific heat. They also have this property that the more energy they lose, the more energy they want to lose. Yeah. Yes? Well, in the second law of black hole mechanics, that's a classical property that holds always, at least under some circumstances. If it's, you know that in statistical mechanics, the second law only has statistical validity. Okay. So the black hole, well, there's also here, well, the black hole reduces its area, it reduces its entropy, but it's emitting radiation. And the total entropy of the system, black hole plus radiation, that total entropy increases. This is something that I'm not explaining here. So the black hole emits radiation, the radiation carries entropy, and this entropy that the radiation carries is more than enough to compensate for the loss in entropy of black hole area. Okay. So this is for the Schwarzschild black hole, but we also saw the Reisner-Nordström black hole. In this case, we have a chart. We can compute the surface gravity. We saw how to do it. And then we can compute the temperature. where this R plus was the radius of the outer horizon. Okay. And you'll recall that in order to have this black hole, we needed to have m greater or equal than q. And the m equals q value was the extremal one. Now, if you now plot the temperature as a function of the mass for fixed q, then you find, well, when the mass is very large, you should recover the same results as here, because if the mass is very large for fixed charge, then the charge shouldn't play much of a role. So it's going to go like this. Then at m equals q, this goes to zero. So if this is m equals q, this should go to zero. And what you have in between is something like this. Okay. So in this case, you see that this is going to be a region of negative specific heat, but here the specific heat at a constant charge is positive. Right? So we have here we have dm over dt at constant q, that's positive, and the specific heat at constant q, this is positive. So black holes in this region, black holes charge, black holes close to extremality, they are thermodynamically stable. Right. So these ones are stable if they are sufficiently close to the extremal limit. Okay. Yes. Yes. Which ones? The laws. Well, yeah, they. No, I mean no. So if I have the these laws of black hole mechanics, they apply in classical general relativity. If I include quantum effects, then the second law is violated. Right, the area of the black hole decreases. What survives is what's called the generalized second law, which says that this should hold. Right. So this could decrease if this increases by a sufficiently large amount. Right. So well, no, so the zeroth law is the one that applies in equilibrium. The first law, it can apply slightly away from equilibrium. Infinitesimally away from equilibrium, I can go from one configuration. Well, as this applies also when, for example, when the black hole is evaporating. And the second law applies in more generality. Applies whenever the null energy condition is satisfied. It doesn't. The second law doesn't require equilibrium. In fact, you go out of equilibrium by increasing the area. Okay. Yes. Well, if you have particles that can be radiated with a right charge, then it will lose charge. For example, a black hole in our universe, if it has charge, it will lose it very quickly. Well, it would lose it first by accreting charge with the opposite sign, but even if there were none, then it would emit its charge very quickly. So in order for this black hole, well, one of the things that you have to satisfy, you can see it also from the first law, if you have particles with a charge E that's larger than their mass, then the black hole will radiate these particles. You can check it very easily because in that case the entropy would go up. Right? If you don't have these particles, then the black hole will not lose charge. So for example, extremal black holes, extremal charge black holes in, say, in n equals to supergravity, if you make them supersymmetric, then in that case they cannot lose this charge because there's no particle available that can carry away the charge. Okay. But in the real world, charged black holes will, well, they are able to radiate electrons. Yes?
If someone has a rotating black
Yeah. Yeah. So you can emit you emit particles with angular momentum just like that, and the black hole is going to slow down.
Is it possible to make it to a sphere?
By
special emission.
So by radiation, by emitting radiation. Let me see. No, it cannot spin up by emitting radiation, but the ratio between angular momentum and mass, I think it can go up in the initial stages. Because you begin by, if you're close to extremality, you begin radiating super radiant modes, and these carry away more energy than they carry angular momentum. Am I right? No, it's the opposite. Let's discuss it later. Yeah. Yeah, because I don't want to say things. I'm being taped, so I don't want to say things that are wrong. Yes. Yeah. So that. Yeah. So the specific. You're talking about the loss or about the specific heat? Yeah, so the laws apply in a lot of generality. There are some conditions that apply to each of the theorems, things like the null energy condition. And so in some cases, you can violate the laws if you put some matter that violates typically some energy condition. And then in those cases, you can violate some of the laws. Right? Yeah, yeah. Yeah, there are ways of violating the laws, but we know under which conditions. These are theorems, mathematical theorems, so we know under which conditions they hold. Okay. So, I'm going quite more slow than I thought. But anyway. So, next thing that I'm going to do, I want to do is to try to find a general formalism for describing these finite temperature properties, these finite temperature aspects of black holes. So, yes?
So, in this diagram,
yes.
If I look at, so initially, what I'm saying
is this is just a plot of this function for fixed Q.
Yeah.
Yes?
So, suppose the radiation is such that the mass of the radiated particles are chargeless, suppose m is greater than q.
Yeah.
So can they will just go to extremal black holes?
Yeah. So you're going to approach extremality as
But
you're never going to get there, or at least classically. Well, at some point there will be maybe one quantum jump that takes you there. But I didn't say anything about the third law, if that's what you're. You want to know whether in the evaporation process you're going to end up here. You're going to approach this. Okay? Whether you can get that would be analogous to the third law of thermodynamics. Because this is zero temperature. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so I want to describe finite temperature properties of black holes. And a formalism that's quite appropriate for doing this is what's known as the Euclidean approach to black hole thermodynamics. In order to do this, I have to first say a few things about what's known as the imaginary time formalism for quantum field theory at finite temperature. How many of you have seen some of this? Please raise your hands, just to have an idea of Okay, so several of you already know some of this. Well, the basic idea here is what's known as the Kubo-Martin-Swinger result, which says that if you have a theory, quantum field theory, at finite temperature in an equilibrium state, then the correlation functions of this theory are periodic in imaginary time. So you can consider correlation functions of a quantum field theory, you can consider them as functions defined on the complex time plane. So you can have, you can imagine that the time variable is complex. So there are some imaginary directions for this time variable. And then Kubo, Martin, and Swinger proved that the correlation functions of a theory at finite temperature in equilibrium are periodic in the imaginary time direction with periodicity. I'm going to call imaginary time, I'm going to call it tau, and the periodicity in imaginary time is beta, where beta is the inverse of the temperature. This is a general result. I cannot prove it. I don't have the time to prove it. But this is a way to formulate. So you can formulate quantum field theory at finite temperature. If you go to the imaginary time, well, to the complex time plane, and impose the condition that your correlation functions have this periodicity in imaginary time. Okay? So you can define, in order to do quantum field theory at finite temperature, you can imagine that your theory is defined on a manifold that has this is the metric of four-dimensional space with imaginary time, and then I take this time coordinate to be periodic with this periodicity, which means that this space is a cylinder where this is the tau direction and these are the x, y, and z directions. So if I solve quantum field theory in this kind of space time, then I'm doing quantum field theory at finite temperature, at a temperature that's given by the inverse periodicity in time. Okay. The topology here, this is S1 cross R3, where S1 is the time, Euclidean time direction. Okay. And then, well, the most efficient way of computing the correlation functions, or the correlation functions, can be encoded in the partition function of the quantum field theory. The partition function, write it as a path integral in Euclidean spacetime, and then I take this path integral over configurations which are periodic in imaginary time. Okay. Now when I have the partition function, this partition function of the quantum field theory corresponds also to the partition function of the statistical mechanical system. You know that the partition function, the statistical mechanical partition function, defines for you the Gibbs free energy. So once you have the free energy, you can compute other properties of the system using standard conventional thermodynamics. This is the formula for the energy in thermodynamics, in terms of the free energy. So this is minus and then the entropy is beta. These are just conventional thermodynamical formulas. Maybe you're not used to seeing them written in terms of beta, but it's what you learned in your thermodynamics. And this is, you also have that F equals E minus TS. So what we'll do tomorrow is to see what does this have to do with black holes. Why am I doing all this? Well, the reason is that there's a very efficient way of computing the thermodynamic properties of a black hole configuration using this formalism. Now, in one of the exercises that you have to do this afternoon, you're going to have to compute the free energy that the Schwarzschild black hole has using this formalism. I didn't get today to see this, but well, I hope that at least you can do the calculation, even if you may not understand precisely what you're doing, but you can do the calculation, then we will have some work already advanced for tomorrow's lecture. Okay, any questions? Yes. 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 Well, we can. So you want to find a solution to the supergravity theory, where you have a black hole which is extremal with non-zero area, and which is also made of a configuration of D-brains that you can understand in perturbative string theory. That's the other requirement. That is, in fact, what was the hardest part, the hardest thing to do. I'm not sure whether this is. In principle, you could have different D-brain configurations, but you have to cook up one that has these properties. And there are not that many. So in many cases, when you put different configurations of the D-brains, you find that the system doesn't have zero entropy. It may have some singularity, or it may have some other properties that you don't want. Okay, more questions? Okay, so we'll continue with this tomorrow then.